Hello everyone, hope you are all fine. So today's lecture will be about carbohydrates. We're going to talk about the structure of the simple carbohydrates, the monosaccharides, and then we're going to talk about the disaccharides as well as the polysaccharides. In the monosaccharides, we are also going to cover the cyclic structure of the carbohydrates and how are carbohydrates converted from the linear Fischer projection into the cyclic form or the Haworth projection. We're going to talk about different types of the disaccharide and as well as the polysaccharides and their importance. Carbohydrates are the main energy or main fuel for our body. Carbohydrates are usually utilized by our body as the primary source of energy. They are also very important for the synthesis of nucleotides, DNA and RNA, because you know that the nucleotides contain the nitrogenous base as well as ribose. Ribose is a 5-carbon sugar. They are very important for structural elements such as, for example, the cell wall. Cell walls contain cellulose, and cellulose is a carbohydrate. And we can find them also linked to other molecules such as proteins and lipids. And these glycoproteins or glycolipids are involved usually in cell-cell adhesion or cell-cell interaction. Now, carbohydrates are divided into either aldehydes or ketones with multiple hydroxyl group. That's why they are known as polyhydroxyaldehydes or polyhydroxyketones. The simplest carbohydrate is the monosaccharide, and the monosaccharides are carbohydrates that cannot be hydrolyzed to a simpler form. They have the general formula of CnH2nOn, where n varies usually from the smallest carbohydrate, which has 3 carbons, to 8. Now, aldehydes are usually known as aldoses, while the polyhydroxyketones, the monosaccharides that have the ketone groups, are known usually as ketoses. So the simplest carbohydrates usually has 3 carbons. This is known as glyceraldehyde when it is in the aldehyde form, and in the ketone form, in the ketose form of the 3-carbon sugar or the triose, the keto triose, this is the structure, and it is known usually as dihydroxyacetone. Another example is the 6-carbon sugar. The aldohexose or the aldehyde of this carbon sugar is the glucose, while the ketone form or the ketohexose is the fructose. So again, monosaccharides are the simplest sugars. They cannot be hydrolyzed into a simpler form. They can be either aldehydes and known as aldoses, or as we said, ketones known as ketoses, and they have the general formula CnH2ON. The simplest carbohydrate is the glyceraldehyde or the ketone form, which is dihydroxyacetone, and the largest monosaccharides usually contains 8 carbons. So monosaccharides are basically classified based upon the number of carbons that are present into. The simplest one are the trioses, C3H6O3, tetroses that have 4 carbons, pentoses such as the ribose that we just mentioned that have 5 carbons, C5H10O5, hexoses such as glucose and fructose, they have the general formula of C6H12O6, the heptoses with 7 carbons, and the octoses that have the 8 carbons. So monosaccharides are the simplest sugar, as we said, and they consist of polyhydroxyaldehydes or ketones, and usually they are present in a cyclized form. Oligosaccharides are short chains that constitute of 2 to 20 monosaccharides, and usually monosaccharides are joined together by glycosidic bonds, such as, for example, table sugar, which is sucrose. Sucrose is a disaccharide formed of 1 glucose and 1 fructose molecule. Usually oligosaccharides that are greater than 3 residues are usually joined either to lipids or to proteins, and these are usually known as glycoconjugates, glycolipids or glycoproteins, while and as we said earlier, these glycoconjugates usually have role in cell interactions. Now, concerning the naming of monosaccharides and disaccharides, all of these sugars usually end with O's. For example, glucose, fructose, ribose, and so on. Disaccharides, sucrose, lactose, maltose, they all end with O's. Now, polysaccharides are carbohydrate chains that contain greater than 20 monosaccharides and up to 1,000 in length. Polysaccharides can be either linear, such as cellulose or chitin. Cellulose is a linear chain of glucose units, and chitin is formed of an amine sugar, which is known as the N-acetylacetylated amine sugar, N-acetylglucose amine. They can be branched, such as in the case of glycogen and starch. And depending upon the sugar residue that usually forms the polysaccharide and the type of linkage that it usually forms, polysaccharides can have very different biological roles. For example, both cellulose, glycogen, and starch, if you notice, they are made up of glucose. However, the linkage is linear in cellulose, while we have branched linkages in the case of glycogen and storage. Cellulose has a specific kind of linkage that renders this molecule a rigid molecule, and that's why it is found in the cell wall of plants. It's a beta-glycosidic linkage, while the linkage in the case of glycogen and starch is an alpha linkage, and these two types of polysaccharides are branched and they act as storage polysaccharides. So as you can see, the depending upon the sugar type as well as the type of linkage, the polysaccharides that are formed can have different biological roles, and that's why we consider that carbohydrates are a highly diverse group of molecules. It could have several polysaccharides formed of the same monosaccharide unit, which is, for example, the glucose, but the way in which they are linked and whether that linkage is linear or branched renders each polysaccharide having a different structure and a different function or biological role. Now, monosaccharides, as we explained earlier, also for amino acids, usually form stereoisomers. And these stereoisomers are based upon two different configurations that are usually known as D and L. Now, the D and the L configurations are usually known as enantiomers, which are the non-superimposable mirror images. So let's look at this example here. If you look at glyceraldehyde, you have one which is D-glyceraldehyde and the other is L. If you notice, in D-glyceraldehyde, the OH is written on the right-hand side, while in the L-glyceraldehyde, the OH is written on the left-hand side. And if you look at these two isomers, these are known as enantiomers because they are stereoisomers, but they are non-superimposable mirror images. Now, if you look at the example of glucose, usually in order to determine whether this is a hexose, of course, whether these molecules that are larger than 3 carbon are the D isomer or the L isomers, we usually look at the chiral center, which is the farthest from the functional group. For example, in the D-glucose, the functional group is the aldehyde. Now, we always start to count from the functional group, which is the aldehyde group, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So, carbon number 5, which is right above CH2OH, is the farthest chiral carbon from the functional group, which is the aldehyde. Because it has the OH written on the right-hand side, this is known as D-glucose. Now, in order to write the L configuration, we said that the L configuration is the mirror image. So the whole molecule has to be reverted. Every OH on the right-hand side now becomes on the left, and every OH on the left now becomes on the right. We don't just flip the OH on the farthest carbon, chiral carbon, on which we determined whether this molecule is D or L. We have to flip the whole image, as we say. So every OH which is on the right becomes on the left, and vice versa. Remember also that the number of isomers that a molecule usually can form depends upon the chiral center. For example, here in the case of glucose, we have 4 chiral centers, which are carbon 2, 3, 4, and 5. So the number of isomers that the hexoses, or for example, glucose can form is 2 to the power 4, which are 16 possible aldohexoses. Of course, these 16, 18 of them are D, and 18 of them are the mirrored images of them, which are L. Now, most of the hexoses that are present usually in our bodies are the D isomers. Remember, amino acids were the L isomers, while the hexoses or the sugars in living organisms are usually the D isomer. So, in general, any molecule that has n number of chiral centers can make 2 power n stereoisomers. Now, what are diastereomers? Diastereomers are stereoisomers that are not usually mirror images. For example, erythrose and threose. These are not mirror images. They are stereoisomers or diastereomers. Now, the Fisher projection is a two-dimensional representation that shows usually the configuration of the stereo centers, of the tetrahedral centers. These are the ones that are usually shown here. Again, we said that in D-glyceraldehyde, the OH is usually on the right, while in L-glyceraldehyde, the OH usually is on the left. Now, all monosaccharides except dihydroxyacetone or glyceraldehyde, for example, they have at least one asymmetric carbon, one more asymmetric carbon other than the central one. So in the case of Mr. glyceraldehyde, the middle carbon is a chiral center, and that's why glyceraldehyde can form only two isomers, which are usually enantiomers. Remember, we said the number of isomers is 2 to the power n, where n is the number of chiral centers. Since glyceraldehyde has only one chiral carbon, 2 power 1 is equal to 2. So by convention, one enantiomer is 1D and the other should be the L isomer. Again, you can see here that the two configurations of the glyceraldehyde, as we said, they are mirror images, but they are non-superimposable mirror images. And you can also notice the perspective formulas for these two molecules. Remember that in the Fisher projection, the horizontal lines usually project from the plane, while the vertical ones are usually behind the plane, as you can see in the perspective formula. Now here you can see the aldohexoses or the aldoses. As we said, the smallest one is glyceraldehyde. Then you have the erythrose, which is formed of four carbons. Of course, you have also the dithreose, and notice that these two are what? These are stereoisomers or diastereomers. They are not enantiomers. Both of these molecules are D, and they differ usually by configurations around certain carbons. Then you have the five carbon sugars or the pentoses, such as ribose, arabinose, xylose, and lixose. And then we have the hexoses, which are the six carbon sugars. You have the allose, altrose, glucose, mannose, gulose, idose, galactose, and tallose. Now, of course, the ones that are marked with a circle are the ones that you should be familiar with, or you should know their structures. Of course, as you can see, these are the DL doses. All of these usually have the mirror images or the enantiomers, which are the LL doses. Now, if you notice here, you can notice that some molecules usually differ around the configuration of only one carbon, and these molecules are usually known as epimers. For example, if we compare glucose and mannose, notice that the farthest chiral carbon from the functional group, which is the carbohydrate marked in green, is usually written in red, and it's always on the right hand side because we said these are DL doses. If you compare glucose and mannose, you will see that glucose and mannose differ in the configuration around the second carbon. In glucose, OH is on the right, and in mannose, OH is on the left. These two molecules are stereoisomers, but specifically they are known as epimers because they differ in the configuration around a single chiral carbon, not more. Now, D-ketoses have usually one less chiral center than aldoses. So if you go back to the previous slide, as you have seen, the first carbon is usually not chiral because it's the aldehyde group, and the last one is CH2OH. Now, in the case of ketoses have a keto group, and that's why they have one less chiral carbon than aldoses. For example, if you compare dihydroxyacetone doesn't have a chiral carbon. Compared to it is aldose counterpart, which is glyceraldehyde. Glyceraldehyde has one chiral center. Another example, if you compare fructose to glucose, fructose has 1, 2, and 3 chiral carbons, while the counterpart, which is the hexose, the aldohexose, usually has 4 chiral carbons and not 3. Now, C4 and C5 ketoses are usually designated by adding UL, if you notice, D-ribulose, D-xylulose, into the name of the corresponding aldose. So D-ribulose is a keto pentose corresponding to the aldehyde, which is D-ribose. Epimers, I have explained earlier, are two sugars that differ only in the configuration around only one of the carbons. So any two stereoisomers that differ from each other in the configuration around a single carbon, these are known as aptamers. As you can see, mannose and glucose, as I have explained earlier, these are aptamers at carbon number 2. The whole molecule is exactly the same, only at carbon number 2. In mannose, the OH is on the left hand side. In glucose, the OH is on the right hand side. If you compare glucose and galactose, you will also see that glucose and galactose, they are aptamers around carbon number 4, which differs between the two molecules. However, if you compare mannose and galactose are not aptamers, they are simply stereoisomers from each other. Now, as we said earlier, pentoses and hexoses do not remain in their linear projection or in the Fischer projection. Usually they cyclize or they take a cyclic form. And that cyclic form is very important in order to protect their functional groups, their aldehyde or ketone, and to prevent their reactivity with certain molecules that are usually present in the aqueous medium. So that's why in an aqueous solutions, monosaccharides that are that have greater than 5 carbons usually occur in a cyclic string or cyclic structure in which the carbonyl group forms usually a covalent bond with the O or with the oxygen of a hydroxyl group along the chain. Now, due to this formation of a cyclic structure between the carbonyl group, whether that carbonyl is from the aldehyde or ketone, and with an oxygen from one of the hydroxyl group along the chain of the monosaccharide structure, a new stereocentral or new chiral center usually results from the cyclic formation, and this is known as the anomeric carbon. Now, anomers are the carbohydrates that usually differ in the configuration only at their anomeric carbons. So when this carbon that was initially non-chiral because it was either an aldehyde or a keto group, due to the cyclization it became a new chiral carbon, a new stereocenter, these carbons are known as anomeric carbons, and anomers are carbohydrates or are isomers that usually differ in configuration around that anomeric carbon. Now, when an aldehyde sugar usually reacts with one of the OH groups, as we said, along the length or the chain of the carbohydrate, that linkage is known as a hemiacetal linkage or an acetal linkage. And when the ketone usually reacts with one of the hydroxyl group, it is known as a ketal or a hemiketal linkage. You don't have to go into details of the reaction. Just know that you have an acetal due to a hemiacetal linkage or a ketal due to hemiketal linkage. Remember that this type of linkage is what leads to the formation of the cyclic structure. Now, the two cyclic structures that are usually formed due to the cyclization or due to the formation of hemiacetals and hemiketals are usually the furans and the pyrans. So the 5 and the 6 membered hemiacetals are represented usually as either pentagons or hexagons, and most commonly written with the anomeric carbon usually on the right hand side to the hemiacetal oxygen. So always the two cyclic structures that are usually formed are either the pentagons or which are the furans or the pyrans, and always the new anomeric carbon is written to the right of the hemiacetal oxygen. Remember that this oxygen, which is present at the top of the rings, is due to the OH group of one of the hydroxyl group that reacted with either the aldehyde carbonyl or with the ketone carbonyl. Now, the two anomeric carbon or the two anomer configurations are either alpha or beta. The designation beta means that the OH, which is present on the anomeric carbon, remember we said it's the first carbon to the right of the oxygen, is cis or downward projecting, upward, while in the alpha it means that it is usually trans and it will be directed downward to the ring. So remember, the 6-membered ring is known as the pyran, and the 5-membered ring is known as the furan. In it in more details, let's look here at the structure of the glucose. We said that the Howarth projection is the cyclic form, and we said when the sugars cyclize, they either take the furan or the pyran form. Now, glucose tends usually to form the pyran form. And for the pyran form to form, remember that we have a hexagon shape. one corner of that hexagon is an oxygen, and the remaining five corners are carbons. So for a D-glucose, in order to form a pyran, a reaction between the aldehyde group, which is on carbon number one, should take place with the hydroxyl group on carbon number five, in such a way that, remember, the oxygen of the hydroxyl group is now at the top of the pyran ring, and the other five corners are usually carbons 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So if you notice here, the hydroxyl group is going to react with the aldehyde group of the sugar. The aldehyde group, or carbon number one, was non-chiral. It became a new stereocenter, and that's why it can form now two different types of isomers that are known usually as enomer. Either the OH is written downwards, which is the alpha enomer, or it is written upwards, which is known as the beta, or as we said earlier, the cis one. Now, regarding the configuration of the other hydroxyl group, whenever the hydroxyl group in the nonenal structure is written on the right hand side, such as in the case of carbon number 2, it will be written downward on the cyclic structure. In the case of carbon number 3, OH is on the left hand side, that's why it is written upwards on the cyclic structure of the glucose. Carbon number 4 is on the right, it is written downwards, and remember that carbon number 5 lost its hydroxyl group. The oxygen of its hydroxyl group is the sixth member of the ring, written in red, and always the remaining carbon, which is CH2OH, is written upward from the ring, towards the up. Now, in order to name the Howard projection, we either say alpha D-glucose or beta D-glucose, depending upon the configuration of the enomeric carbon. D-glucose, because this is a D-sugar, remember, in carbon number 5, OH is on the right-hand side. Or we may name them as alpha D-glucopyranose or beta D-glucopyranose, to denote that this sugar has formed usually a pyran ring. So again, in order for a sugar to cyclize or form the Howard projection, the cyclic structure, a reaction usually occurs between the functional group, which is either the aldehyde or the ketone, at carbon 1 in case of course of aldehyde, and carbon 2 in the case of ketones, with one of the hydroxyl groups. In the case of a pyran, it will be carbon number 5. So the aldehyde carbon now becomes a new enomeric carbon. We could either draw it alpha or beta. Both are correct, and for the remaining carbons, whenever the configuration of the OH is on the right hand side, it's drawn below the ring, and whenever it's on the left hand side, it is usually drawn above the ring. Another example is the formation of the cyclic form for D-ribose. Now, remember, riboses are pentoses, and in the case of five-membered rings, the structure is a furan. Here, the reaction is between the aldehyde at group number 1 and the hydroxyl of carbon number 4. Again, as you can notice, marked in red, the new anomeric center or stereocenter is due to the cyclic structure. The aldehyde carbon is converted to a new stereocenter. And again, the OH there could be drawn either below or above the ring, either the alpha or the beta isomer. Now let's take an example of a ketose, which is a polyhydroxyketone. If we take the example usually of fructose, has the functional group or the ketone group at carbon number 2. So when these types of sugar, or when ketoses usually cyclize or take the cyclic form, in order to draw their Howard projection, always the reaction is between the carbonyl of the keto group, which is marked in blue, with the hydroxyl group at carbon number 5. Now, if you count the carbons here, they are 1, 2, 3, 4, as well as the fifth member of the ring, which is the oxygen, which is why the keto hexoses usually form furan structures and not pyran structures. Again, carbon number 1, which is the new stereocenter, which is always written to the right, of the oxygen on the furan ring, is now a stereocenter. Either the OH is written downwards, and this is known as the alpha enomer, or upwards, which is known as the beta enomer. Now remember also that to this carbon we still have a CH2OH group, which is written opposite to the OH, depending upon whether the cyclic structure that you are drawing is the alpha enomer or the beta enomer. Again, OH on the left are drawn upwards, such as in carbon number 3, they are drawn upward, and OHs on the left are drawn downward. Of course, carbon number 5 has no OH, and always, because its oxygen is now the fifth member of the ring at the center of the furan ring, and CH2OH is always drawn upward of the ring. Notice OH below, this is the alpha, and OH above, this is the beta structure. Again, the naming is either alpha D fructose, beta D fructose, or we name them as alpha D fructofuranose, which is the cyclic form, or beta D fructofuranose. Both are correct. Now, aldohexoses can also form five-membered rings. They can also form aldofuranoses. However, the six-membered aldofuranoses are usually more stable, and that's why they usually predominate. And this is why whenever we draw the aldohexoses in a cyclic structure, we usually draw them as the six-membered rings or the pyrane form. The ketohexoses usually, as I explained on the other side, can only form the pyranose ring because the C2 ketone and not aldehyde usually reacts usually with the carbon number 5. Now they can form pyranoses if their carbonyl carbon, which is at C2 of the ketone, reacts usually with the hydroxyl group at carbon number 6. Now remember that always whenever the sugar cyclizes or takes the cyclic structure, there is always an interconversion between the animals. So whenever you have a solution of an aldohexose or a ketohexose, always the alpha and beta animals interconvert usually in the solution by what is known as mutarotation. There is always, of course, a certain equilibrium. One of the animals will predominate, but always both animals are usually present in the solution. So if we take the example of D-glucose, in D-glucose the solution forms an equilibrium where 64% of the animals are the beta, because it's the more stable. Remember, beta is when the OH is upwards, and 36% of the animals are usually the alpha. So always both animals are present in a solution of either an aldohexose or a ketohexose. Remember, aldohexoses tend to always form pyrans or aldopyranose ring because they are more stable. The ketohexoses usually form the furan, but they can also form pyranose ring if carbon 2, carbonyl carbon 2 of the ketone group forms a cyclic structure with or a reaction with the hydroxyl of carbon number 6. Now the pyranoses are usually not planar ring. We draw them for simplicity by the Haworth projection as planar rings. However, usually, because the carbons usually have a tetrahedral geometry when they are saturated or when they are forming four bond, usually pyranose rings assume two configurations, either usually the chair configuration, and in the chair configuration, as you can see, you have certain equatorial bonds and you have the axial bonds. Always the equatorial bonds are usually less sterically handled by their neighbors or what is around them. Usually the bulky groups are always therefore in equatorial positions. So whenever you have a CH2OH, the CH2OH, as you can see, which is a bulky group, is always in an equatorial position. Boat conformation is another kind of conformation that is seen usually in sugar derivatives, because these sugar derivatives usually contain a large number of bulky groups, and this enables the bulky groups to take the if you want, the equatorial position. So again, pyranose rings in their Haworth projection, they are not usually planar, or when they are in cyclic structure, they are not planar. They usually take two conformations, either the chair conformation, in which the bonds usually, or the hydroxyl groups and the other groups attached to the ring are in an equatorial and an axial position. The axial one are usually more handled, the equatorial one are less directly handled, so every group that is usually bulky is usually in an equatorial position. Notice that in the example that is written here, which is the alpha D glucose, the OH on the chiral carbon, as we said, which is the first carbon to the right of the oxygen, is below the ring. Okay, And another confirmation is the boat confirmation. The boat confirmation usually is seen in sugar derivatives, where there are usually bulky groups that are added upon or replacing the hydroxyl group on the ring structure. Now, if you compare here the orientation of groups for carbons number 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 in the host and in the chair projection, remember we said that the chair projection can take two forms, as you noticed in the previous slide, you will see that in each case the hydroxyl groups are up, down, and so on. And if you look deeper into it, you will notice that always the OH groups are in their equatorial position, because we said that the bulky groups have to be in the equatorial position, which is usually the more stable one. So if you compare the beta D glucopyranose with the previous slide, you will notice that always the OHs, they are up down respectively, and this up down is always in the equatorial position. At the furanose conformation, furanose usually form what is known as the envelope form. You don't have to go into details about the ring atoms and the distances. All that you have to know is that they usually take the envelope form. And if you look at the shapes below, again you can notice that there are two different conformations for the envelope form. Notice here are carbons 1, 2, 3, and 4, and again here you have carbon 1, 2, 3, and 4. In the second conformation, you will notice that C2 is lacking here a hydroxyl group, and this is the deoxyribose that is usually seen in DNA. While in the first conformation, C2 still has the OH. It's a different envelope conformation, and this is the ribose that we usually see in the ribonucleic acid. So in beta D ribose, a moiety of most biomolecules, either carbon number 2 or carbon number 3 is usually out of the plane of the ring, and on the same side usually as carbon number 5. So either carbon number 2 or carbon number 3 is usually out of the plane of the ring at the same side with carbon number 5. Carbon number 5 is the CH2OH moiety. And also notice that in deoxyribose, the second carbon is usually lacking the OH group, and that's why it takes a different conformation or a different envelope form than the one with the ribose sugar.